William D. Hackett, but everybody calls me Bill. I was born in Rangoon of missionary parents. My father and mother were under the American Baptist Foreign Mission Society, as it was known in those days. They went out on the 100th anniversary of the arrival of Judson in Rangoon, and I was born the next year. So you see, I've had a different kind of a way of growing up than many. I was very proud of the work that my father and mother did. And so as I grew up as a boy, I learned how to value what they were doing. Then I came back to the United States from my high school and college, and I kind of, like all young fellows, I kicked over the traces for a while. But in my third year in college, I decided that perhaps I wanted to go back and serve on the mission field.
Bill, were you in Burma right up until you came back for high school?
No, I came home with my parents at the end of World War I. And it was a rather horrendous trip across the Pacific. I was only 4.5 years old then. And we were here 2.5 years while my father got additional training at the University of Chicago Divinity School in Christian education. So after I got out of college,
I'm still going to go back some.
Okay.
Your parents did not send you to the Missionary Children's Home at Newton or...
Oh, yes, they did. I was in Granville for 3 years.
That was
when I was in high school. We came home my parents came home for a second term in 1928. And we were in Springfield, Missouri for 15 months, and then they left me at Granville at the Missionary Children's Home the fall of 29.
Well, now, there were a lot of just little tykes there, weren't there? Didn't some of the missionaries send their children home when they were just 5 and 6 years old?
Yes, there were some. There were some, but the kids I would remember, of course, were the older ones.
Yeah.
In high school, junior high and high school, and we were quite an imposing group, actually. There were a lot of athletic young fellows, so that we just about dominated the athletic program at Granville High School for 4 or 5 years.
Who were some of them? Did they go on to...
There was a Rogers family. I can't remember all the names now, but
yeah,
there were 3 or 4 of them in a string, you know. And they were from Burma also.
What about Dick Cummings? Was he... He would have been before you.
No, he was... They were at
Newton.
At Newton, yeah. Bigelow from the Philippines was there, and Metzger from Roland. He was one of my classmates, as a matter of fact. And we played football together. So, growing up with them, of course, I knew a lot of them very well. Anyway, after I got through college, that was one of the low periods in the American Baptist Foreign Mission Society. And I mean low. There just wasn't enough money to support people. And I applied, and they pushed me off by saying that I was too young. Well, I was only 22. But the fact I'd been born in Burma and that I could speak Burmese almost like, as well as a Burmese, you know, that should have gotten me out there, except there were no finances to send me out. So with the help of Dr. Anna Barbara Gray and another missionary, Mrs. Heptenstall in Burma, I was able to get back to Burma in 1937, a year after I graduated from college. I went back because I was afraid that I might be going back for the reasons of nostalgia rather than for the real call. And so I was out there 2.5 years. And during that period, I traveled all over the country. And there was a group of people up in the Shan States where I'd gone to school as a boy, interestingly enough, who had never had a foreign missionary. And there were about 170 Christians in 3 churches at that time. And so I went out there and I went up to Taungi, and I was able to go to a couple of their meetings. One was a big annual association meeting. There were quite a few missionaries there. My mother was there, and Carrie Hazeltine, and quite a few others were there. And while I was there, it was one of these 3 or 4 days affairs. They really have big associations over there for long periods. And while I was there, why, some of the older men, as Bo'os of the people who were largely around Taungi and to the south. Taungi was a place where I had gone to school as a boy, where there was, again, a missionary children's school. And I was confronted by 3 of the older men in this group. And they said, "You're the son of a missionary, aren't you?" And I said, "Yes, my mother's here." And they said, "Well, you know, we've wanted to have a missionary who would just give their time to us. Will you be that missionary?" And then I knew I had a call. Well, I hadn't had any theological training at all, just had a BA. So I told them, "Well, I'm coming back. I'll go back and get some training, and then I'll come back." And they said, "Oh, we're afraid to send you back. We're afraid you won't come." And I said, "Oh, I promise." So I came home to America, and I entered Hartford Theological Seminary, which at that time had the best mission school in the United States, Kennedy School of Missions. And I kind of picked and chose among the courses I took. Having lived there, you know, as a boy, and then knowing that I was going to missionary work with people who were not too well developed yet, quite culturally developed, but backward in terms of technology and all these things.
These were the Shan people?
No, the Bo'os. The Bo'os. They're a Karen group. And they had escaped from Lower Burma and come up into the Shan States. They escaped one of the kings down there, who was a king at the Tone. And anyway, they asked me to come. And so I came back to the United States and did some study in the Kennedy School of Missions. And I emphasized those things which I thought would be most important to me in missionary work. And that would, of course, have been, I left out church history, because those people, they didn't care about all the ancients that we think about in our historical thinking. I did a lot in New Testament and a lot in Old Testament, and but primarily a strong base in theology. And also, of course, I took various mission courses. At that time, Hartford had the finest mission library in the country. So I pored over these various books that were in the library. And they also had some very fine teachers there, a man from Africa who had worked among the Swahilis, a Britisher, Edwin Smith. He wrote a lot of books, at least 40 books he wrote. Anyway, he was my senior advisor on my thesis. And, you know, my thesis was right down the alley, at least I thought it was. I took a study of animism and then the Christian approach to animistic peoples. In other words, here people have these beliefs about spirits and mostly evil, and about all the influences of darkness, And so how does a Christian present the message of Christ to them? I found it very, very useful. And interesting enough, a lot of people who were working among animists read it and said, well, now that gives me new insight. Now, I don't claim I got all these things myself. I just gathered them up, but I put them together so that, a person like Bob Johnson, who was working in the Chin Hills, he read it and he said, oh, it gives me a lot of insight into this. Anyway, it was very useful to me. While I was at Hartford, I met Marion. She was going to be a home missionary, but I just changed the location of her home was all.
She was from Belchertown?
Belchertown, Massachusetts, yes. And she had come to Hartford on a scholarship from the Congregational Church. Well, I won't go into the long story of it, but we were married the second year. I was writing my thesis and getting married and trying to get ready to go back to Burma all at once. And it was quite a heavy load for a while. And we went back.
Sarge and Janet Matson were at Hartford.
That's right. Sarge and Janet Matson have been our good friends ever since. Yeah,
well,
they were there at that
time. They talk
time.
About you often with a great deal of fun.
Yeah, well, we've kept up lots of contacts with them. Anyway, you know what happened in the end of 1941. See, I was at Hartford between 39 and 41. And they gave me a master's degree in Oriental religion and philosophy. Now, that's not usually what you think of a seminary degree, but they were granting MAs and PhDs at Hartford at that time. And I didn't see any use in getting a BD like everybody else in the U.S. had, because there were so many things that I would confront that the BD wouldn't be useful to me. I had a hard time with the dean for a while. I had to argue and argue, you know, that I knew what I was talking about. But he finally gave in, and so I took 2 years of work and wrote this thesis and got married, and then went back in the fall of 41. Well, you know what happened in 41.
You went back to Burma. Before you go back to Burma, didn't Marion already have heart problems at that time?
Yes. Yes.
We
had a hard time getting her past the medical people. Lippard, who was in Zaire, he and his wife went out, and contrary to what they should have done, his wife worked like a dog. She was a nurse, you see, and they were trying to get this medical work started early in Zaire, and so she came down with heart problems. So here's Lippard, who was sitting on the medical board, saying, well, she's got heart problems, and he thought back to his own wife, you know, and he kept saying, well, I don't know whether we ought to let Marion go or not. Well, I don't think I'm patting myself on the back. I was a valuable find as far as missionary was concerned. I had all the background. I plunge right in, speak Burmese without a stop, you know, no long period of learning, sort of thing, and I knew the culture and all the rest, so they considered me a very good find. R. L. Howard, who was then at the Burma desk on Madison Avenue, he said, we got to get you out there. So we kept going around to various specialists on heart problems. Lippard was not necessarily a heart specialist.
No, not at all.
And we went around to the heart specialist, and finally we find a guy on Park Avenue that said, well, he said, I don't see any reason why she won't have as good life out there as she will here. Well, that was all we were waiting for. That was enough approval as far as the board was concerned. So
you didn't have to sign a waiver or anything of that sort?
No. And it's amazing, you know, she lived to be 71, and all that rough life, so Lippard was just a little bit prejudiced because his wife had suffered in the first term of service. You know, they were out there only 5 years.
Is that the Lippard who was editor of Mission Magazine?
That's there? Right, yeah. Same one. Yeah. Anyway, you know what happened in 41? That's Pearl Harbor. One of the interesting things was that we crossed the Pacific from San Francisco to all the way down to Australia, then up through the Indonesian islands to Singapore and then Rangoon. And we were carrying armor plate for Chiang Kai-shek on that ship. Well, the Japanese submarines were prowling all through the Pacific, you know, and they didn't have enough crew on that. So they called for volunteers. There were some flyers who later were with the Flying Tigers, you know, they're kind of famous in history over there. There were some flyers. Well, I felt I had good eyes too, so they assigned us. It was a 6 weeks trip, and all the way across the Pacific, we had to have people watching on the prow, on the stern, and in the crow's nest.
Now, had Pearl Harbor already occurred?
No, it was just before Pearl Harbor, okay. But the Japanese were already trying to stop this stuff because it was going to Chiang Kai-shek, you see. It was a big Dutch freighter with only about 80 passengers on it. Anyway, I spent one whole week on the crow's nest like this, you know, and the Pacific really rolled, I could tell you. It was really quite an experience. Anyway, we wended our way through. It was a Java Pacific, which meant it stopped at Java twice, and then on to Singapore and on to Rangoon. And we got to Rangoon October. I went over to Maulmain, where my parents were, and introduced my wife to them. They'd never met her. And then we went up to our station.
Did they approve?
I think they did. anyway, we went up to Tangji, and we had just arrived in Tangji when the bombers began invading Burma. Well, we stayed for a while. We dug trenches and we ran out and got into them every night. There was an alarm, you know, for about a month. We didn't get much of our stuff unpacked. And, you know, everything was topsy-turvy. We didn't know whether what was going to happen. So we didn't unpack stuff. Then they hit Tangji. And we got out of there real fast. Fortunately, I had a truck, and I loaded most of the things we had brought from America onto this truck and went up to Nam Cam, where Gordon Seagrave was operating that hospital on the border, you know. And he took me on as an ambulance driver. Well, we had a lot of exciting experiences. I think the most exciting was that the Japanese came through Burma almost like a dose of salts, you know. They just went whoosh. Took them about a month to get from Rangoon up into the central part of the country where we were. And then they came north. Well, when we were told to evacuate, I had the nice job, or doubtfully nice, of going out and picking up nurses from Gordon's hospital. He was down on the front operating on soldiers, the Chinese army. I had to go around and pick up his nurses who were scattered all over the country there. And, well, it was a close call. I was out old Trans-Salween, which was on a terrible road, I picked the nurses up there, and I came into Senwi and then Kutkai and north. There was about four groups of nurses I had to pick up along the way in northern Burma there, and got to the And I didn't know what was going on. All I could hear was the Zeros flying overhead occasionally and a bomber now and then. But I had no communications, you see. Got back to the place and my wife was just frantic. She had been acting as a nutritionist at Gordon's Hospital for the Westerners. We had some Westerners who were injured and who came into Gordon Seagrave's Hospital. Dr. Gray was there at that time and a number of others.
Barbara
Gray, yes. Marion acted as a nutritionist. When I got back, she was terribly upset because she thought sure she was going to have to leave without me, you know. I got back and about midnight, and 2 days later, day and a half later, we went over to Loy Wing, which was south of, the southern part of Yunnan province, just across the border. And the Flying Tigers had one of their bases there. And the empty planes that had taken in supplies to Chiang Kai-shek at Kunming flew back, and they swooped into this Loy Wing airport, which was just across the border. And, of course, there were thousands of refugees waiting. They had heard that there was this big crowd trying to get out, you know. Well, because we were Americans, we got some priority on it. These were American planes, but they were just cargo planes. And while we were getting on the plane, believe it or not, the Zeros came in. Well, the guy and I, the pilot of our plane said, come on, get in there. He said, one bag apiece. And that C-47, which is normally carried about 27 or 28 passengers, had 93 on it.
That's the C-47.
And it took the whole airfield to get them off the ground, you know. Well, 1-0 chased us, but they have a very limited, they had a very limited range, you know. They could only fly a few hundred miles, and he chased us for about 20 minutes. And our pilot kind of wove through up north in Burma there are lots of mountains. And we just kind of wove through the valleys of the mountains. We could look out and see the startled villagers in their villages right off the wingtips, you know, sort of thing. But that's why we avoided them, because the Zero had only one man, and so they had to dive in order to shoot, you know. All their guns were out of the front of the plane. Anyway,
the Zero was a lot faster than the C-47, wasn't
it? Yes, well, not an awful lot. This guy opened it up, and it was going about 185, and the Zero was only about 210 or something like that.
Oh, I thought they were faster than that.
No, they weren't very fast. But anyway, we got out by the skin of our teeth. But all of our wedding presents, all that we had planned to use for 6 years, was stuck there in Nam Cam at Dr. Seeger's hospital. Well, I had a gun. I took it along. It was taken away from me in India, when I landed in North India. That's where the plane took us. Later, 4 or 5 years later, some fellows who were with the Mennonites, I think it was, who were up there on peace work, you know, and running hospitals and dispensaries, a fella came to me and showed me one of my pairs of pajamas, which he had looted out of our stuff there. Well, the way I knew it was something my sister-in-law had given me with my name on it and all the rest of it, you know, all that kind of stuff. And he said, well, you know, I always hoped I'd find the guy that had these before I got them. It was a topsy-turvy world then, you know. Well, I got into India, and the only jobs that were left, people had been escaping from Thailand and from China and from Burma, into India. And so I'm speaking of missionaries now.
Right.
So the Indian missionaries had a little bit of the feeling, will God save us from any more missionaries? They offered me a job of chaplain with the troops, USO. And I just didn't feel that that fitted my role as a missionary. So we went across the country. My father and mother were in Burma, in India then, and we went up to see them again. The last time I saw my father. And then we went down to Karachi. Karachi was where the American Army and Air Force men were coming in to be shipped across the whole of India to Northeast India to build up our strength against the Japanese over there, to help the British and Indian armies, you know. And we were permitted, after a wait of a time, to get on a troop carrier that was returning the United States empty. It had brought 5,500 boys over on it. And I can tell you, it was real rough accommodation. But we were glad to get on a boat. And I was especially glad because they needed crew members. So I got on the crew. I was called a utility man, and I did all the dirty work that none of the other sailors that were regular sailors wanted to do, you know. I got my first experience with a dishwasher then, because they put me on the dishwasher most of the time. And I washed dishes for 1,500 people for that six weeks trip back to the United States. I can tell you, I lost 10 pounds and I was just fagged out when I got to New York. And then before I could connect...
What was the dishwasher like?
It was a big steam dishwasher. So you fed it, you know, and pushed it out the other side. Other people took the dishes away, but I took the dirty dishes, got the worst dirt off, and put them in there. It was a steam washer.
Yeah.
But even then, I spent 11 hours a day washing dishes on that doggone boat. What's that?
1,500 people, that's a lot.
That's a lot of people, yeah.
You came up with a good complexion, though, didn't you?
What's that?
Good complexion with all that steam.
Right, right. Well,
these were all mostly civilian passengers.
Mostly civilians, and many, many of them missionaries from all... A lot of Indian missionaries got upset, excited, you know, and left. So I would say two-thirds of them anywhere were missionaries. Well, I had to stay in the crew quarters. My wife was upstairs in on one of the bunks, and these were just hammock bunks, you know, and they had them stacked up five deep in some places.
I've been there.
When I got to New York, though, in order to collect my pay, I had to join the National Maritime Union. And that was in the days of Harry Bridges. So I got a mug shot. So if you ever see me, I belong to Harry Bridges' Communist Union, you know. But I did collect a good pay because we were considered to be in war-torn waters. And so they doubled our pay. And
were you in a convoy or just by yourself?
We were by ourselves. It's a big ship. But as we got closer to the U.S., a couple of destroyer escorts picked us up and went dashing back and forth in front of us, you know, looking out for submarines. That was a time when the Germans were sinking hundreds of boats in just off the Atlantic coast, you see.
Yeah, right.
And so...
Well, you were on the Pacific coast.
No.
Oh, you came...
We came around the horn, around the horn to New York. Around the Cape of Good Hope.
Hope, yeah, not Hope.
Yeah. See, you couldn't go through the Mediterranean because the Germans Italians would take it over down there. So we had this long trip. Another 6 weeks, but I did get enough to earn a car, to buy a car when I got here. Back in those days, you could buy a Ford for $500, you know, and I just Baptist, we knew we were going to be moving around, so